Thank you very much for having me. Thank you for that kind introduction. And now for something completely different. Today, I want to talk to you about stories. I'm a stories guy. And sometimes when I'm speaking to audiences about narrative, it's a bit of a hard sell, but I think that actually, for many of you, you already know how important stories are, how the human mind is constantly constructing stories to deal with the pace of events, especially events as they happen rapidly in highly stressful situations. We throw out most of the data. We can't handle it. We can't keep in our heads all of the information coming in through our eyes, through our other senses. We need to throw most of it away, keep a few fragments, and assemble them into a narrative that lines up with the story we've had in the past and the story we're going to tell in the future. So I want to start this talk by making this clicker work, which it doesn't seem to be. Maybe it turned itself off. Here we go. Let's see if that'll do something. Nope. Could somebody help me with my clicker, please? Point it in this direction? Okay, we'll do that where I can see the slide. Yeah, all right, so we're going to start with the thesis. Ooh, it's working. The thesis is, go back. Okay. The thesis is that stories are not just important for constructing ourselves, for dealing with the present. Stories are also fundamental to how we deal with this problem of what's going to happen next. Stories are the building blocks that we use to make the future. So that comes in terms of this notion of narrative, of creating a causal model of the world. That's something that we do with stories. We try and figure out why things happened. And on a very practical level, we do this with vocabulary. If we don't have the words, so in terms of technical innovation, if we don't have the word, it's very, very difficult to conceive of the idea. And one of the things that science fiction, which I'll be talking about a lot in the next half hour, is particularly good at is coming up with new words. Because if you don't have new vocabulary to describe the thing that you want to make, if you don't have an idea that you can use to describe that thing to somebody else, to share your vision, it's very, very difficult to get people to buy into this story, to buy into a future. So science fiction provides a shared language for foresight. One of the things that I'm sure you've all observed when it comes to technology, when it comes to technical innovation, is that we have all sorts of words. We have all sorts of language. We have all sorts of disciplines and sub-disciplines, organizations and subcultures where people use different kinds of language. They specialize. They distinguish themselves from everybody else. They come up with secret words and trade words and sign words that are almost explicitly intended not to translate so that we get a Tower of Babel situation. We have all sorts of ideas about the future, but we can't communicate them to one another because we're not using good storytelling. We're using really bad storytelling. So science fiction is a way to cut through all that. One of the people that we collaborate with at our center is the science fiction author Neal Stephenson, and he has a great line that a good science fiction story can save you hundreds of hours of PowerPoints and meetings because it can take everybody and put them on the same page, not in terms of all of the technical details, but in terms of the big idea. And if you have the big idea together in unison, then people can go out and solve their parts of that big idea one by one. This is how you do something like the Apollo missions. So there are a lot of benefits to using science fiction as a pragmatic tool for thinking about the future, for wrestling with complicated challenges. The first one is it's really cheap, right? You don't need a lot of money. You need some talent. You need some time. You need to bring the right people into the room. But that's much, much cheaper than trying to build the thing and then finding out that it doesn't work. Science fiction allows you to extrapolate from a number of different fields and allows you to integrate them together. So what makes a really good science fiction story is not that it's got one wild idea. What makes a really interesting science fiction story is when you have five different ideas and they're all brought together and allowed to play out. So you think about Star Trek, it's about the warp drive, it's about the communicator, it's about the matter transporter. And that universe works because all of those things come together and you explore the social life, you explore the human endeavor, you explore conflict and resolution through all of those different iterations on things that on their own are interesting but abstract. You ground them all together into a into a believable universe. Science fiction allows you to check assumptions. If you pursue this notion of narrative fidelity, if you put human characters into a future using these technologies, all of a sudden you confront problems that you wouldn't have thought of when you were just looking at something like a technical design spec. You start thinking about, how are you going to carry this thing around? Does it live in the kitchen or the living room? How do you turn it on? Does it turn off? All sorts of really obvious but important things that operate at the intersection of what Bruce Sterling and some other people have called design fiction. When you take your world building seriously, you think about storytelling as an exercise not just in character development, not just in plot, but also in terms of setting, in terms of objects, and sort of taking your technology seriously, and seriously not just in a technical sense, but in a human and a social sense. Maybe most importantly, science fiction and narratives more generally are one of the best tools that humans have to deal with complexity. If you think about a good story, a story can be complex, it can be nuanced, it can engage with complex problems, but still provide a through line, still provide a story that we can follow. And when I was talking about that notion of throwing out data before and narrowing in on the things that really matter, that's how we humans deal with the complex problem of being alive, right? We construct a story, and dealing with complexity involves figuring out what's not important and zeroing in on what is. So narrative is a way to capture and deal with complexity, providing some fidelity to the complex nature of the problem, but still giving you a line on it, giving you an idea of how to deal with it. So let me give you a couple of examples of how science fiction has played a sometimes quite important role in technological development. I want to get this date right. I think it was 1914, H.G. Wells wrote a novel called The World Set Free. World War I was much on his mind, and he imagined a near future where people would be able to drop bombs the size of oranges that could destroy entire towns. It was an early vision of the atomic bomb. He actually assumed that this would be based somehow on the power of the atom. In the 1930s, the physicist Leo Szilard read this novel and realized that H.G. Wells was onto something. And he was actually the first guy to come up with the inspiration, the realization that there could be a nuclear chain reaction if you found the right kind of atom that would produce two neutrons, where only one would be absorbed by the process of breaking that atom apart. And so through his relationship with this science fiction idea, he first filed a patent with the British Admiralty to try and protect this idea of a chain reaction so that it wouldn't become public, somebody else wouldn't sort of announce it and get the word out and perhaps let it fall into the wrong hands. And then he was instrumental in convincing, nagging, berating Albert Einstein into writing to President Roosevelt to start the Manhattan Project. All of this because somebody had come up with this idea in fiction first. There was another writer, whose name I forget, who wrote a story in one of the pulp science fiction magazines in the middle of World War II, which was eerily close to what was happening at the exact same time in the Manhattan Project about scientists racing to try and develop an atomic weapon. And he got a very uncomfortable visit from the FBI because they thought that he was somehow linked to an espionage ring, or he somehow had secret information. But this was just a remarkable instance of people working on the creative side, people working on the complex narrative problem, coming to the same conclusions that people working in the trenches of the technical challenges were coming to. A second example, a little more recent, I find this fascinating. There's a guy named Fyodor Berezin, who's a Russian-born Ukrainian, who is a science fiction writer, has published a number of novels. In the late 2000s, he published War 2010 and War 2011, which were eerie premonitions of this sectarian conflict in Ukraine with Russians battling NATO forces. Obviously, it wasn't entirely lined up with what really happened. But my favorite part is he then became the deputy defense minister of the People's Republic of Donetsk. So he was the science fiction guy who wrote the novel that he then lived. Not sure what to do with that, but it's very interesting. So let me talk a little bit about methods. There's something interesting here. There's something interesting in the relationship between science fiction and technological innovation, between the ways that we think about the future in a cultural and imaginative sense, and the way that we deal with the future as an engineering challenge, as a set of social challenges, political challenges. So one of our first big experiments around this is something we call hieroglyph. And this was an effort to take that relationship that we know exists from stories like the H.G. Wells stories, that feedback loop between science fiction and technical innovation, and to tighten that loop, to actually construct it ourselves deliberately rather than waiting for some idea to circulate like a message in a bottle and land in the right hands and cause something important to happen. So for hieroglyph, we started with this idea that science fiction, one of the powerful things that science fiction does is it creates iconic ideas. Things like the Star Trek communicator, like the rocket ship, like the robot, like the submarine. And to think about how those ideas, powerfully expressed by entities like Star Trek, like Isaac Asimov, like Robert Heinlein, Jules Verne, those ideas somehow become lodged in our cultural consciousness. They become sticky in a way. It would be, I think we'd be hard-pressed to find a roboticist today who's not familiar with Isaac Asimov's idea of the three laws of robotics, that there should be these ethical guidelines. That idea somehow has become deeply entrenched in everything we think about when it comes to robots and society. And all of those science fiction ideas are deeply entrenched in the technologies that we were actually building that relate to these different visions of the future. And in certain cases, you could make the argument that the story wasn't a prediction, it was a path breaking. It was a way to open up the possibility to this potential future. So science fiction is a way to explore a broader possibility space around what might happen. And one of the things that we need to do, one of the exercises we collectively need to engage in, is to make sure we're not just telling the same stories over and over again. We've seen that movie. They actually recycle the props often in Hollywood movies. They'll take the cool-looking gun from one science fiction movie and smuggle it into the background of another science fiction movie. I find that fascinating, too. So what happens if we set out to construct the feedback loop ourselves and we actually challenge well-known science fiction writers to work directly with scientists and engineers to come up with technically grounded, optimistic visions of the near future? Big, ambitious stuff that we could actually do now, or we could do in the near future, that don't require unobtainium, that don't require any magic, that don't require faster than light travel. And so the formula we came up for this was big ideas, real science, great stories. And Hieroglyph is a collection of those stories. It's on Amazon. You should buy it right now. The book that came out of the process that I'll talk about more about in a second is really not the end, and it's really not the primary output. We didn't go into this thinking that we were going to come up with a set of ideas that we would then spend the rest of our careers trying to implement. The exercise is about imagination. It's about trying to open up a possibility space and inviting people on the most fundamental level to think about the future as something that we can change, to feel that we have a sense of agency in building a better world. So I'll give you a couple of examples of these stories. So one of them is by the journalist and sometimes science fiction writer, Annalie Newitz. She talked to people working in solar energy, people working at the intersection of biological complexity and social complexity. And she came up with two different visions of the future of the city that in both cases thought of the city as a kind of organism. So in the first one, very explicitly thinking about the city as a kind of cell, with where all of the different transits of energy and resources are like the transits of energy and resources within a cell, which as we're to our dismay beginning to realize is a lot more complicated than we thought it was. And then the mound city, which is an exploration of very pragmatic bioengineering, so that when you have a house, your house might be something that's almost like a plant that you grow, and you have to take care of it or your house is going to get sick. The second one that I think is also really powerful is by Carl Schroeder, and this was an exploration of how you might use things that are off-the-shelf technologies today, augmented reality, glasses, the growingly rich layer of ubiquitous computing and data that exists at a, you know, around our urban landscapes, how you would take that and start to create new ways of seeing the city. So if you're house hunting, as the characters in his story are at the beginning of that story, you might look around the neighborhood and not just see what your eyes report to you. You might see all of the zoning plans and papers that have been filed with the city for future developments, some modeling of where people are going to be walking, what are the busiest streets, where there might be a new shopping market. You might also see things like a model of where all the money goes, who owns the buildings, where the rich parts of town are. And you could imagine all sorts of other overlays that you might put over the city, not from the top down, right? Not as something that you look at through Google Earth from 50 miles up, but something that you do personally, viscerally, exploring that space yourself. And the other really interesting thing that Schroeder explores in his story is this notion that we imagine all sorts of technological improvements in the future, but we still think that decision making is going to be exactly the same. We think it's going to be Captain Kirk making some gut call about what's right, what the right move is. And so he imagines a different alternative where people might actually, you might be able to use some of these technologies to come up with new kinds of collective decision making that would actually lead to better outcomes and to better shared understanding of what that decision even is. So I want to talk a little bit about megacities. Well, before I get to megacities, let me take a minute to talk about that. So I gave you a couple of examples of what we did with Hieroglyph, but I want to talk a little bit more about method. One of the really important things that we're trying to do here is to think about imagination as a set of practices, as a skill set, as a faculty that you could call upon, something that you can learn how to do. I'm very interested in this. This is an ongoing area of research for me. How do you get people to think more imaginatively? Inviting them into compelling stories is one way, opening up that possibility space. But you also need to give people the tools to be not just consumers of stories, but to become participants, to become creators of stories. And so what we did in Hieroglyph was we thought about this challenge of how do we get these people together? So we had somebody like Neal Stephenson, a well-regarded storyteller, someone who really knows how to write a novel, and he said, I want to talk to this structural engineer I found at ASU. We had no idea whether this was going to work. So he came, he got in touch with the structural engineer, this guy who spent 20 years building steel, well, working on the structural engineering of steel buildings, safety. He serves on the national boards around safety standards for steel construction. And so his question to this guy was, how tall can we build something? And this was the moment where I was really not sure whether this engineer was going to say, "This I can't do this," or if he was going to be intrigued. And he was intrigued because his response was, nobody's ever asked me that question before. That's not a question that we get. We don't think about the moonshot. We think about incremental progress. We think about margins of safety. And this is the kind of question that could inspire my students, that could inspire whole conversations that you can't answer by turning to chapter 2 of the structural engineering textbook, which, by the way, that engineer wrote. So they started talking about this idea of a tall tower, how a tall tower that doesn't require any kind of magical techniques that don't exist, something that you could build out of steel now. And almost immediately, you realize that thinking about that tall tower requires talking to a whole range of different experts in different disciplines, thinking about the upper atmosphere and winds, thinking about where you're, the ecology and the resource constraints of where you're going to get all that steel, thinking about seismology and where you want to build something that tall, where there might be earthquakes, thinking about politics, thinking about religion. What's it going to be like to live in the shadow of something that's maybe 20 kilometers tall? So the exercise for getting people to work on problems imaginatively is about balancing freedom and constraint. You have to give people the freedom and to give them the comfort level to ask really bold, ambitious questions, really challenging questions, and give them the freedom also to try and answer those questions in ways that aren't bounded by their disciplines. But you also have to give them the constraints of of producing something, the challenge to create a narrative that's compelling. You have to facilitate those conversations as you move along. And this notion of a method for something like hieroglyph is something we continue to refine this and explore it in a number of our different projects. How do you invite people from very different backgrounds into the same conversation and get something out of it? So it's not just about everybody having a nice chat and then going off to what they were doing before. It's about distilling that into some new idea, some compelling nub or seed that could grow into a whole new vision for the future. So let me talk a little bit about megacities. These are some observations from a very different perspective, I suspect, from a number of the speakers you've had so far. I want to start with a wonderful book by Italo Calvino called Invisible Cities. In the Invisible Cities, Kublai Khan is an old blind emperor, and he's found this young Italian traveler named Marco Polo to tell him about his empire, because he can't visit it anymore, he can't see it anymore. He's a total victim of his own success. And it's a remarkable book. It's not really about that plot in any sustained way. It's about this notion of seen and unseen. It's about the notion of the city as a kind of metaphor for all sorts of different things. Now, I'm not going to wax poetical on you, don't worry. But I want to talk about that notion of the city as an intersection and the city as seen and unseen. So cities are places where ideas, cultural forces, religions, political systems come together, intersect, come into conflict, but also come into productive tension. They're also the intersections of interfaces and control systems. When you think about things like the smart city or the bizarre mix of ancient and modern infrastructure systems, the fact that we're still using Roman plumbing in a number of parts of the world, but we're also putting up Wi-Fi networks and who knows what sort of next generation layers of ubiquitous computation and sensors. Cities don't lose their past, they just accrete new layers of information and new layers of culture. They absorb the invaders and acculturate them into something that becomes distinctive and new. And so most importantly, cities are about the seen and the unseen. And what you do in a city, especially when you're thinking about complexity, when you're thinking about megacities of the future, if you think about your own life, when you walk down a city street, what are the things that you choose to see and the things you choose not to see? The homeless guy on the corner, the cars that are parked there, the way in which the traffic is ordered, the choices we make about social decorum and taboo and which way we walk. All of these are very simple quotidian examples of really high-stakes systems, cultural systems or socio-technical systems, where it can occasionally become really important to understand how they work and how the outputs work. And deciding what's significant, what has meaning in the complex environment of a city is all about that choice between the seen and the unseen. So Carl Schroeder's story was about taking certain invisible things, invisible, powerful things, and making them visible. And I think that notion of imaginary geographies, cultural geographies, geographies of conflict, of threat, geographies of drought, geographies that are temporal as well as spatial, are going to be increasingly important as we try and grapple with the complexity of the urban environment. This is an interesting art project that was recently completed in Cairo in the slums, really, where Christian garbage collectors live. So in Cairo, there's a culture that it's almost a caste-like system where there's this familial network, this sect, this group of people who collect the garbage from the rest of the city, and they process it there. They have pigs, they have goats, they throw stuff out, they sort out the valuable materials, and it's a caste looked down upon by many other residents of the city. But for whatever reason, a European artist group decided to go there and to do this art project without asking anybody's permission, as an experiment, just sort of going into the neighborhood, starting to talk to people, and gradually coming up with this idea. What I like about it is that you can only see this final work from a particular vantage point on a hill above the neighborhood. But it captures the complexity of the urban environment, and especially this kind of environment where we've all seen images of places like this before, unregulated growth, the sort of growing complexity of the urban built environment as things get piled upon other things. We're going to be coming to terms with this kind of multi-layered and multi-dimensional narrative over and over again, where people in cities, there are multiple layers of observation and surveillance and communication that are in conflict with one another, sometimes creating unintended consequences, building upon one another. And we're going to be searching for these moments of perspective that, again, become a way of seeing the world anew. One of the other interesting things about imagination is that if you ask an artist or you ask a scientist how they do their work, they're going to tell you it's all about finding a new way to see the world. Picasso and Einstein said the same thing. I don't know if this statistic has come up already, it probably has, but I was really struck by this idea that the average stay for a refugee in a long-term refugee crisis is now 17 years. So that's how long you would spend in a camp, potentially in a place like Turkey, elsewhere in the Middle East. And we're going to be having more of these problems as the waters rise, as people come to terms with a number of different crises, not even the political crises, but just the climatological crises that are going to be coming our way. So that notion of the permanent emergency becomes really important. We're thinking now about cities and megacities as places that have some kind of long-standing logic. There are the world's great cities, Mexico City, Istanbul, Beijing. These are cities that have been around for a very long time that have a long accreted history, but we now have both the opportunity and the obligation and the technological power to create cities overnight. The logic by which we create these cities can often be arbitrary. It can be provisional, it can be contingent. But then those decisions become permanent in a way that we never wanted them to, in the way that nobody ever wanted them to. So coming to term with the megacity also as this provisional emergent problem, something that continues to metastasize over time, is going to be really important. One way that you can think about the military effectiveness of the United States is our ability to create a city almost overnight anywhere, right? So that notion of the technological production of urban space is divorced in a lot of ways from the things that we all used to think mattered. Access to water, access to transportation. There's the example of, what's it called, a Black Rock city every year, Burning Man, which is, again, the invention of a city in the middle of a desert and one of the most inhospitable places you could imagine. I want to close with a little riff, a little playing around, a little narrative construction around the city. If you think about it as a permanent emergency, that's another way to talk about ecology, to talk about the ongoing balance of conflicting interests that constitutes human or biological systems in general. The quest for life, the quest for survival and reproduction. So if you think about the city as a space that is also its own ecology, we could do that in a little bit more of a concrete way by thinking about one technology that's already being used in all sorts of ways in urban environments, military and non-military. So we're already at a place where people are using drones to deliver humanitarian aid and to aid humanitarian efforts. You can start thinking about if that becomes a more popular and more frequently used method of dealing with humanitarian crisis, that people will start trying to catch the drones. They'll then take the aid packet, just like happens right now in the Middle East, and they'll put their own sticker on it, so it's no longer a UN. It's no longer a UN a food packet. Now it's branded with the Islamic State or something else. And then you can begin to think how the drones will be cheap from, or relatively cheap from a Western perspective, but might be quite valuable from the perspective of the resource-starved area where they're being deployed. And so people will be repurposing them for all sorts of other things. And we're already at the stage now where we're giving drones a growing envelope of autonomy. So you could imagine that these humanitarian drones might be instructed not just to go to a particular place and drop off their resources, but to look for the right kind of person or the right situation to land. And so that kind of behavior, you can start to see how they might, especially if they're manipulated or part of that CPO gets hit by a piece of shrapnel, that the drone might develop its own sort of wild behaviors, erratic behaviors. So people realize that you don't really need to strap an MRE to the drone when you can just make the drone edible. Let's give ourselves 10 years for that one. Chicken, pasta, beans. It's probably going to be beans, right? It's going to be lentil drone. So then it becomes even more interesting. Birds are going to start to get really interested in drones if you can really eat them. You don't have to pry apart some metal container to get at the food. And people will get more serious about it, too. People are already using their shotguns to shoot drones down out of the sky, but how much more exciting if you can then eat your kill? And then the response might be that you're going to take your if you want to play the propaganda game, you're not going to rebrand the drone as the Islamic State drone. You're going to poison it, right? These are some of the tactics that we've seen in other conflicts where there's this sort of psychological element. So now the drone looks like the others, but somebody has made it no longer quite such a tasty treat. That maybe to solve that problem, you try and come up with some way to cue the drones to the people that you think you're trying to help. So you set up the drone, maybe that's to particular individuals so that only those individuals will be able to unlock the drone, or the drone will only respond to them or fly to them. Or maybe there are groups of people and you try to do this through some kind of genetic ethnology. Sure, that'll be really easy. And then you can imagine how people will try and spoof that system, right? They might try and find somebody who's of the right, who's got the right DNA signature, and get them to sort of take receipt of the food drone, and then hand it over to the bad guys. What's interesting in this little narrative that I'm playing out here is that we're increasingly moving towards a system of autonomous ecology, right? We tend to bring technological solutions to bear on problems that we've defined. This is the engineering logic. You identify a problem, and then you identify a solution to that problem. But cities and megacities are probably the best example of how those technological solutions get reinvented and rewritten by people who are more imaginative and who come up with their own answers, who fill in their own who cross out the words on the official elevator pitch and come up with something entirely different. And that notion of ecology, I think, is it's a viral one. It tends to take over and absorb other systems of control. And so as you can think of now about urban landscapes as ecologies, you can think about the pigeons that are gradually turning their feathers gray to match in with the gray urban landscape of the East Coast in the US. That's going to happen to our machines, too. The more autonomy we give them, the more they're going to start to operate in this unclear, ambiguous, complex system of the urban environment. And the example here I'm using of drones can be applied to all sorts of other technological systems, all sorts of other interventions that we might try and make into an urban environment. And I think the last line I have here, that computation, the behavior of the drones will come to resemble the weather, applies to many other things. What I mean by that is that the technological system we deploy will increasingly be a complex system that's ambiguous. Just like We still struggle today to figure out whether it's really going to rain tomorrow. We'll struggle to figure out what's actually happening with our complex systems. I'm fascinated by the fact that even today, the top engineers who are building complex machine learning systems, algorithmic systems at places like Google and Netflix, they can't explain to you why some particular thing happens in the system. The systems are too complex. They've exceeded the scope of the understanding of any one human being at a practical level. Humans we can understand them through layers of abstraction. We can understand, in a general sense, why something might have happened, but we can't tell you why this actually happened. And that's a space we're going to be continually operating in collectively. We're building complex systems. We're designing computational responses to that complexity. But we're giving up some important agency when we do that. So I want to close by talking a little bit about what narrative has to do with all of this. Storytelling is a way to deal with complexity. Imagination is what you can get out of stories. Imagination is the faculty you can prime, that you can develop. And what you really want out of these stories is not, none of this is going to happen, right? This little drone narrative, I don't think it's going to play out that way. But the exercise of thinking about it might prompt some of you to think differently, or might give you an idea that will turn into something that does happen, or give us an idea about something that we don't want to happen. What stories do, what imagination does, is it strengthens our resilience. It gives us another set of tools to deal with the complexity of megacities, to deal with the complexity of our increasingly interconnected and ever more rapidly changing world. And that resilience is the thing that we really need. Thank you very much.
Questions?
Professor, you alluded to Jules Verne in your talk. And I'm amazed how in 1870, for example, he's writing, Round the Moon and 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, things that actually came to be 100 years later. Who are the modern day Jules Vernes and what are they writing about?
Ask me in 2115. I think, so I'll answer your question by saying that it's deceptive, it's misleading to think of science fiction as a predictive tool. It occasionally gets things right. Jules Verne was sort of remarkable, right? He's off the charts in terms of his accuracy in predictions. But even Jules Verne got lots of things wrong. He thought we would build a giant gun and use that to launch people to the moon. So it wasn't quite right, but he did figure out we would do it from Florida. And he knew that the Americans would do it, but he figured being Americans we would build a giant gun, which is understandable. So science fiction is not that useful for prediction, and many science fiction writers will tell you that, but it's very useful for thinking through the possibility space. And so every once in a while you get it right. But if you don't explore the full possibility space, you could miss something really important. And so it's very helpful in trying to think through those black swan scenarios, where it's not so much that you want to nail your short-term analysis exactly. It's trying to think through the potential consequences, the unintended consequences, especially, and again, with the complex interface of different systems and how those can have unintended consequences.
So I suppose you already answered this question, but in things like the IARPA, the super forecasting initiatives and things like that, there seem to be some empirical results that suggest not much is very good for making predictions that are accurate, other than perhaps frequent updating of your beliefs. But I was wondering if any empirical work had been done, in fact, on the utility of narratives as, making it so that you do get a lot of those details more right than you would have otherwise.
Funny you should ask. This is actually a topic I'm very interested in. We're doing a little bit of research around this right now. But I'm not so interested in forecasting yet. What I'd like to try and prove is, or explore, is whether there's historical evidence to find that there are ideas that circulate between science fiction and science or technical innovation. Because if you can prove some kind of, maybe if it's not even a causal relationship, but just some kind of correlative relationship, that's a pretty interesting beginning. And then you could start to look at things people are writing or talking about now and try to make some guesses about what might happen in the future.
That was a wonderful talk, thank you. You mentioned that some of your current work is looking at how you can activate imagination in people who aren't professionally imaginative. I guess I'm wondering if you have any insights or hunches you might share with us on how to best do that.
So this is, again, something I'm still thinking about myself, but I think, at least anecdotally, what I said about freedom and constraint is really important. So, and also, I have to say, what's strikingly important is finding the right style or the right tone for the invitation. You have to get people to step into a new space if you want them to let go of their assumptions. You have to find a way to invite people to be a little crazy and to think outside the box. And so you have to prime them, but you also have to structure them, because if you just say, you know, think outside the box, be crazy, it's not going to be very productive. And actually, what people do is they end up just recycling ideas that other people have had. They don't really end up extending and doing something genuinely new. We fall back on cliches. And so finding that balance, that scope to give people enough rope to do something interesting with is really important. And I think that when you look at the practices of people who are professionally imaginative, as you put it, whether they're physicists or sculptors or professional athletes, you could argue in certain cases are doing this, people have a variety of very pragmatic techniques that they use. And so this is an open area for me. I'm starting to think about how you might try and distill those into a set of practices.
I'm interested in your favorite Neal Stephenson book and a little bit of the plot for the audience.
Oh, that's a good one. So I'll give you a classic that we're actually working on right now, which is The Diamond Age, or The Young Lady's Illustrated Primer. So this is a novel that has a lot going on, but I'll tell you two things. The first is it explores the idea of nanotechnology and answers the question through a narrative, well, if you could just print anything in your house, what are people going to do all day? Nobody needs to buy anything. How do you do with a culture of abundance? So that's very interesting. But the second thing Stephenson does is he uses this idea of nanotechnology to imagine a futuristic book that could recognize you, it could teach you how to read if you don't know how to read, and it can be a lifelong, incredibly personalized, adaptive learning tool. So it can teach you everything from martial arts to calculus to Boolean logic. And the core mission of this book as an educational tool is to teach people to be subversive thinkers, to learn how to think for yourself. So that's a really interesting prompt. And President Crow, who you heard from this morning, has asked me and some other colleagues at ASU to actually get students to think about how we would prototype books or prototype ideas inspired by that novel. So that's one of my favorites.
Let's give Dr. Finn another hand.
Thank you.
So for the group that was at the table with me at lunchtime, I subjected you to this discussion about the culture of abundance. And so as robots and artificial intelligence make unskilled labor and then eventually skilled labor less viable, what do you do with these large populations of educated people who no longer need to work? So this whole concept of cultural abundance is actually quite fascinating. And you think in terms of the demographic, right now we have large, in some places where there's youth bulges, we have large pockets of young unemployed males who become very disruptive, mm-hmm. and with weak governance they end up being problematic. So this whole culture of abundance, how do we harness that for our advantage is quite an interesting topic. But I think it's interesting, we started today with a story about a Mississippi mule who was entered in the Kentucky Derby and, as I was reminded, was better for the company. And I would offer that we have been better for the company as well. And I thought that I thought I captured one among the many things that I captured from your talk, this idea of big ideas, real science, and great stories. Reminds me of the Burnham quote, where he, for those of you who go back to New York, the Flatiron Building on 23rd Street, the first skyscraper. And Burnham has this great quote. He says, "Make no small plans. Only dream greatly, because it's only great dreams which inspire men to greatness." So your ideas of big ideas, real science, and great stories, like that Mississippi mule, have greatly enhanced us. We are much better for the company, and we're pleased to have you as a member of the Mad Scientists.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you all.